it takes two people to carry this thing up. Good morning, Crossroads. I just want to say thank you for either joining us here in person or listening online. And like Pastor Am said, my name is Zach Sams. I have been attending Crossroads Community Church for 5 years and have been following Jesus for 4.5 of those. And for those of you who don't know me, there are a couple things that you need to know. One, I love America. I mean, I really love America, right? I served in our armed forces, I've traveled around the world, and I believe we are so blessed to live in the land of the free and home of the brave. Thank you. You can clap for America. And second, I'm married to an incredible woman named Karina. When we were planning our wedding day, I fought for July 4th. It was a Saturday. It would have been perfect, right? But Karina wanted January 4th. So, of course, we negotiated, and we ended up with January 4th. Thank you. Just over 3 years ago, I started dating my wife. And at this point, I had been following Christ for a while now, and I couldn't get enough of him. I lived for him. I was part of two life groups. I was being discipled by guys and discipling others. I was memorizing scripture, and I was doing everything I could to grow in my walk. I had all that I wanted, except for one thing, a wife. And if you ask some of the guys in my life at that time, it was my number one prayer request. I thought God wasn't going to bring a woman into my life, and I'd end up being just like Apostle Paul, right? I'm serving God faithfully. God, why aren't you bringing what I want? Crazy. Kind of pathetic, actually. But it just so happens that in one of my life groups, there was this incredibly attractive woman who loved Jesus. I wanted to get to know her so badly that whenever we broke up into small groups, it just so happened that I would end up in hers. And after a few months of knowing Karina, I knew I wanted to marry her. And a year later, we were married. Life was great. However, after the honeymoon phase, things seemed to change. Can I be honest? Marriage is hard. I mean, painfully hard. And what I started to realize was that sometimes you can get what you want and miss what you really need. What I wanted was a wife. I thought marriage would fill the emptiness in me. I put these expectations on her that she was going to be the answer to what I needed, that she would answer what was missing in my heart. And that created a lot of problems for our marriage early on. But what I really needed was to find my satisfaction and my values in Christ and expect Christ to fill my needs. What I really needed was to find my security in Christ. I got what I wanted, but missed what I needed. And here's my point, church. Sometimes when you get what you want, you can miss what you really need. Think about your life. What is it that you want from God? Some of you are in the same spot I was. You are in a season of singleness and you're wishing for a spouse. Or maybe some of your marriages are hurting and you're hoping for a change. Unfortunately, there are people here today that are struggling with addiction and want God to free them. But maybe it's not that extreme. Maybe some of you just want a new car or a new house or for your business to succeed. There's nothing wrong with wanting. God gave us the ability to desire. But be careful that when you get what you want, you don't miss what you really need. And listen, today we're going to look at a story of a guy who experienced a miracle that he wanted, but missed what he really needed. And listen, this is so important. For some of you, the worst thing that could happen is to get what you want from God, but miss what you need from him. So as we examine this man and his encounter with Jesus, we're going to come across three needs that Jesus comes to meet in our lives. Whatever you want from God, this is what you need. And if you miss these three things, you'll miss everything. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to John chapter 5. For those of you who didn't bring your Bibles, there's a couple copies in the back. Otherwise, you can pull out your phones, turn to the Bible app, or our Crossroads Community Church app. Otherwise, the verses will be on the screens around me. Now, this is where our story begins. John chapter 5, verse 1. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now, there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. You see, we just read that Jesus comes to a pool called Bethesda, which in Aramaic means house of glory. And this pool is filled with disabled people. And because of this, the upper class or anyone wishing to be ritually pure would avoid this place at all costs. You see, back then, it was not okay to interact with these people because it was believed that if you interacted with them, you yourself would become unclean. I mean, look at this illustration of the grace of God. While people avoided this place at all costs, Jesus, the Son of Man, approaches. And the reason why this pool was surrounded by societal outcasts was because it was believed to have healing properties. You see, it was believed that when the water was stirred, an angelic being was doing the stirring, and that the first person who entered the water after the stirring would be cleansed of their disability. And as we continue, we meet one specific man. This man had been an invalid for 38 years, and it's assumed that he's either paralyzed, lame, or extremely weak. I mean, can you imagine being this man? For 38 years, this man suffered physically, but it didn't stop there. He also suffered emotionally and relationally. You see, during this time, a man's worth was equated to his work, and because he couldn't work, he had no worth. So not only was he physically lame, he was also rejected by society. This man was the epitome of hopelessness. But look what Jesus does when he encounters this man. Verse 6. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" I mean, this is my favorite part of today's passage. Jesus asks if this man wants to get well. Like, did Jesus really have to ask that? I was really hoping Peter was nearby so he could say some boneheaded remark like he usually does, right? I mean, this guy had been an invalid for 38 years. What kind of question was that? Jesus knows this guy's physical state. Surely he must know this guy's heart and desire. But let's see how this guy responds. Verse 7. "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Like, are you kidding me? Jesus asks if you want to be healed, and this is your response? Talk about a complete letdown. I was expecting something like, "Yes, yes, I want to be healed." But no, all we see is excuses. Not only was this man's body paralyzed, but so was his will. He is the ultimate healer in front of him. Ask him a question he's probably been hoping for the last 3 decades, and he starts listing off excuses and blaming others. Unbelievable. This guy was so desperate and clinging so tightly to the hopes that the water would heal him that he couldn't realize it was Jesus who heals. But this is exactly the first need that Jesus comes to meet in our lives. Some of you here today need to know that Jesus comes to heal. I will say that again. Jesus comes to heal. When this man thinks it's just another day, Jesus comes and initiates a relationship. And that's usually what happens in our lives, right? We don't search for God, but God searches for us. This man didn't come to the pool looking for Jesus. Jesus came to the pool looking for the man. And right now, some of you are just like him. You're stuck in the same old situation, the same struggle, day after day, same hopelessness. Yet, this could be the day that you encounter the resurrected Savior. But the question Jesus asks us is, do you want to get well, right? Maybe Jesus does want to heal you physically. Maybe he does want to heal you mentally or emotionally. He definitely wants to heal you spiritually. But we have to decide we want to get well. We want to cooperate with the work the healer wants to do in us, right? I mean, you see, for a decade, I was addicted to pornography. I mean, it would cripple me. I would avoid hanging out with friends just so I could go look at it. And at times, I would forget to eat a meal because I was so preoccupied in it. It wasn't only influenced me negatively, it was also affecting my relationships. I knew the negative effects porn had on me. I didn't like who I was when I was watching it, and I tried to stop countless times. And of course, occasionally, I would be good for a week or two, but I just couldn't seem to shake it. Then one day, Jesus initiated a relationship with me. And when I realized that Jesus was the healer and that I wanted to be closer to him, that's when I really wanted to change. But sometimes it's easier to lean on our excuses for why we can't get well. Sometimes we don't actually want to change. Sometimes we don't believe things can get better. But Jesus invites us to turn to him because Jesus came to heal. Where do you need Jesus to heal you? Some of you are struggling with depression and anxiety, and it seems at times there's no hope, no solution. For years you've begged and pleaded with God, "God, take this from me," but he just won't. Or you see people that don't know him, and they don't seem to struggle with this. It's just not fair. For others, right now you have a broken relationship with a family member or a close friend. Maybe they said something or did something to dissolve your trust. Maybe they hurt you. Or maybe, just maybe, it's not their fault but yours. You're the one that lashed out in anger. You're the one that said things that you regret. And instead of approaching them and seeking for forgiveness, you distance yourself because it's easier that way. Or to be quite frank, you don't want to be healed. It's way too much work to reconcile that broken relationship. I mean, it was their fault, right? Shouldn't they be the ones crawling back to me? But you see, Jesus came to heal you, and he wants to heal you. But it might not be how you think or want. Look how Jesus responds to this man. Verse 8. Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once, the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. You see, Jesus wasn't even fazed by this man's excuses. Even with this man's lack of faith, Jesus heals him. He gets up, secures his mat, and takes off. This man has been in this state for 38 years, and with one conversation with Jesus, he's been miraculously healed. Incredible. Jesus gave this man the miracle he wanted, the miracle they didn't even believe was possible. But something's wrong. And it has to do with this man's response to this miracle. And what's wrong isn't what the Bible says happened, it's what it doesn't say. Do you see what's missing? Jesus miraculously heals this man, but he doesn't have one word of gratitude. He doesn't say, "Hey, thanks, man," or fall at Jesus' feet in worship, right? No, instead he jets off. There's no record of even one word of thanks. Let me ask you something. How would you have responded? Like most of you, I would say I would have fell at Jesus' feet and worship him. I would have said I'd stop everything and follow him. However, I don't think I would have. You see, there are days where I experience something only Jesus can do, and I completely ignore it. Or worse, I take credit for it. The sad truth is there's some conversations I have at work and the gym pertaining to the gospel and sharing the good news that I pat myself on the back and say, "Nice work, Zach." Or I go home to my wife and mention in like a humble brag, you know, like, "Hey, babe, guess what I just shared with this guy?" The reality is it's all about me and those circumstances. I take my eyes off the one who actually orchestrated the conversation. What about your miracles? Some of your marriages have been struggling for weeks, months, or maybe even years. And recently, you had a breakthrough, and your marriage is finding the healing it needs. What do? Do you chalk it up to your work? Or do you give glory back to God because of his grace and mercy? Others, you've been living paycheck to paycheck for the last year and a half, and you finally have some breathing room. What do you do with that money? Do you go back to spending it, or do you give it back to God for his faithfulness? And listen, there's some people that are either have cancer or know someone that does. And when the doctor comes in and says the cancer went into remission, what do you do? How do you respond? Do you praise the healer, or do you praise the 21st century medicine and technology? The sad truth is, we can laugh and give this guy a hard time, but we aren't different. We beg and we pray for our circumstances to change. And if they do, we ignore God and continue on with our lives. And that's exactly what this guy did. He just wanted to be healed. He wasn't really interested in Jesus. He just wanted the miracle, but he didn't care about the miracle worker. But as we saw last week, the purposes of miracles are to point people back to Jesus. It was to demonstrate who he is. This man should have said, "That was amazing. Thank you so much. But sir, who are you?" But he didn't. Because he didn't care about the healer, he just wanted to be healed. Let me ask you something. Are you looking for the healing or the healer? Do you care more about being healed than the healer? Are you looking for the healing or the healer in your life? If you find that's you this morning, I encourage you to allow God to search your heart. For me, when I wanted a wife more than I needed God, I had to repent and turn back to God. My priorities were not in line with his. If you desire your wants more than God himself, you might want to do business with him this morning because your priorities aren't in line with his word. You don't seek God because of what you can receive. You seek him because of what he has already done in your life. God sent his son to take our place on the cross so we don't have to live a life separated from him. That's why you seek him, not because of the miracles he can do. Jesus came to heal, but he came to heal so that we would turn to him and seek him more. We wanted to be healed, but what we really need is the healer. That's the first need Jesus comes to meet in our lives. For the second need, check out the second half of verse 9. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath. As we read in verse 9, John briefly mentions that this healing took place on a Sabbath. And for our American audience, it's easy to skim over this and continue reading. But for John's audience, the stage was set. The reader knew something was about to happen. Keep reading, verse 10. And so the Jewish leader said to the man who had been healed, "It is a Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat." But he replied, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" So they asked him, "Who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk?" The reason why the mention of the healing taking place on the Sabbath was so crucial is because of what we just read. Like if it happened on any other day, no big deal. But this wasn't an ordinary day. This was the Sabbath, the holiest of all days. You don't do work on the Sabbath. And it wasn't the healing that upset the Jewish leaders. It was the fact that this man was breaking their laws. And because of this, the Jewish leaders stopped him. They didn't care that he was healed. They didn't care that a miracle just happened. They cared that this man was defying their teachings. These men prided themselves on their knowledge. They could recite the Torah from memory. To bring it closer home, it's equivalent to a person who was baptized as an infant, grew up in a religious home, went to a Christian school, was confirmed by the age of 13, and can memorize verse after verse. But because there is no love in their conversation you have with them, you walk away feeling that they're arrogant or hypocritical. You see, it wasn't a coincidence that this man was healed on the Sabbath. I think Jesus purposely healed this man on this day. I think Jesus knew that this man would run into the religious leaders. Jesus knew that this man was going to blame him for the healing. You see, Jesus knew the end game. And this is the second need Jesus comes to meet in our life. Jesus comes to set us free. People living during Jesus' time were so concerned with following the laws, 613 to be exact, and if they mess up just one, they knew they would be persecuted. Jesus came to show that he is equal to God, that he is equal to the Sabbath. He came to free people from the religious pressures of the Jewish leaders. He came to show that the only way to be made righteous is through him alone. Jesus came to set us free from trying to be right with God. And if I'm honest, church, this is my current struggle. My passion and my desires are for all Christians to know the Lord and to truly live for him in every aspect. But, unfortunately, I come off as a religious zealot, a Jewish leader at times. Just ask my wife. She sees it firsthand. I have extremely high standards for myself, And there's nothing wrong with that if two things. One, I don't fall into a rut in trying to earn my salvation. And two, I don't place those high standards on others. And that's where I've been. I've been trying to place my standards on others. I've been trying to force others to jump through my hoops. I care more about my expectations that I forget it's not about me. It's about the cross. I can't save people. Only the Holy Spirit can. And regardless of what you do or do not do, we all fall short of the glorious standards of God. And that's the problem with trying to be right, being right with God by being a good person or following religious rules. You see, the law is a really good thing. The only problem, we can't keep it. And what was meant to bless us and show us how to live becomes a standard that judges and crushes us. While the people and the leaders were preoccupied in trying to earn their salvation, they completely missed the fact that Jesus comes to set us free. How are you guys doing? Are you trying to earn your salvation? Listen, it doesn't matter how many church services you attend. It doesn't matter how many Bible verses you can memorize. It doesn't matter how many Bible studies you are in. And it sure doesn't matter how good of a person you think you are. The Bible's very clear that no one is good. And if you're like me, you might feel guilty once in a while when you miss a daily reading. Or for others, you're guilty when you don't pray for a certain length of time. Listen, if that's you, you might be struggling with legalism. And now hear me out. I'm not saying reading your Bible or praying to God is a bad thing at all. It's actually a really good thing. What I'm saying is if you think you can earn God's love or favor, you're dead wrong. And when I start to slip into this pattern, the only solution is to look to the cross. The cross shows me the unconditional love of God, that while I was still a sinner, Christ bore my punishment. No law or ritual can save me. And whether you're struggling with legalism or have been hurt by it, you need to turn to the cross. Jesus came to set us free. Listen, no matter what you've done or haven't done, you're not right with God. Plain and simple. Salvation is not by works, but by faith. And this brings us to our last point. Jesus doesn't want to just heal you physically or just free you from the suppression of legalism. Let's keep reading and see the next need Jesus comes to meet. Verse 14. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, "See, you are well again. Stop sinning or something worse may happen to you." After this man threw Jesus under the bus, we come to this verse. Once again, we see Jesus taking the initiative and a great example of forgiveness. After the first interaction between these two, the man went on the way with his life. But Jesus was looking for him again. Why? Jesus gave this man exactly what he wanted. The man wanted to be healed, and Jesus did it. So what else does Jesus want to do? You see, this verse in today's passage had me puzzled. I've read this passage countless of times, and I never understood what 14 meant. You see, it doesn't fit right. Like, it's out of place. This miracle is just another story of Jesus healing someone and them coming to faith, right? But verse 14 counters that. And I ask myself, what could be worse than being an invalid for 38 years? What, maybe 39? The only thing that could be worse than what this man has already experienced is this: eternal life without Jesus. Not once in the 14 verses we've read has there been any sign of faith whatsoever. This man is the ultimate sign of unbelief. I mean, this man met Jesus twice. He was physically healed. He experienced the power of God firsthand. And yet, he still didn't believe who Jesus was. Let's continue reading, verse 15. The man went away and told the Jewish leaders that it was Jesus who made him well. This man still doesn't get it. Clearly, this man never wanted a healer. This man never wanted a savior. All this guy cared about that was that his circumstances would change. This guy wanted a miracle, but completely missed the point when he received it. And with this, we see our third need Jesus came to meet. Jesus comes to bring us to surrender. The man just wanted a physical healing, but needed a spiritual restoration. The Jewish leaders wanted to look righteous, but needed a savior. Jesus comes to bring us to surrender. We just read about a man who experiences Jesus and his power, but failed to realize who Jesus was. And throughout the Gospels, we read miracle after miracle, right? And like this man, some have gotten it wrong. But for others, they got it right and responded appropriately. In Luke chapter 5, we see an interaction between Peter and Jesus. Jesus just finishes teaching this crowd, and then he turns and focuses on Peter. At this point, Peter is drained. He is exhausted. He just spent all night fishing and caught absolutely nothing. Jesus looks to Peter and tells him to put down his nets. At first, Peter was hesitant. I mean, do you blame the guy? This guy was a fisherman. If anyone knew how to catch fish, it'd be him, not some carpenter. But then we see a little bit of faith and obedience, and Peter lets his nets down. And instantly, the nets were filled. How does Peter respond? Look at Luke chapter 5, verse 8. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." And finally we see why Jesus came. Jesus came to be Lord. You see, Peter didn't care that a miracle happened. He didn't care that this was probably the biggest catch of his lifetime. No, Peter realized Jesus was Lord. He dropped to his knees and told Jesus to get away from him because he was unworthy to be standing in Jesus' presence. He knew that he was a sinner. He knew he wasn't righteous. And at that moment, Peter responds the way everyone should, repenting and surrendering to the lordship of Jesus Christ. What would happen if we got this wrong? What happens if we experience miracles but miss the point? What happens if we're healed but don't turn to Jesus? What happens if we do get that new car or that new home or new job and we fail to surrender to Jesus? Church, please don't miss this. We can experience blessing after blessing and not be right with God. We can be successful and never be any closer to Jesus. You see, if we respond like the man who was healed, we will be separated from God. However, if we respond like Peter and confess Jesus is our Lord and surrender our lives to him, we can experience a deeper relationship with him and spend eternity with God. Listen, some of you here in this room or listening online, you've experienced Jesus Christ, and he is your Lord. Praise be to God. But for some of you, you aren't sure whether Jesus is your Lord. You might not know what it looks like or how to surrender your life to him. And for others, you don't even know Jesus. And if that's you, I beg you, please reach out. Don't leave here uncertain. And listen, if you want to know what it means to have Jesus as your Lord, please text the word LORD on the number on the screen, 920-7171-715. Or write LORD on your Connect cards, place them in the black boxes in the back, or the connection team. One of the members on our pastoral staff will reach out to you and just connect and discuss with you. Or stick around after a service, talk to me, talk to one of them, meet us at the picnic. But please, I can't emphasize this enough. Listen, this isn't something to be taken lightly. This is a matter of life and death. And as I invite the worship team to come up here and close in song, I just ask that you please bow your heads and pray with me. Jesus, we just thank you. Lord, we just thank you that you are the healer, Lord, that this life can't heal us the way that you can. Lord, I just pray that we would just seek you and remember that we can't earn our salvation. We can't be made right with you by our works. It's all because of your son on the cross. Lord, I pray that we would just surrender our lives to you. Lord, that we would make you, Lord, and put you back where you belong. And Lord, as we live out and step out today, I pray that Christ would be magnified in us. In your son's name, amen.